Let's get going. We got about 213 people on here right now. So I'm excited to introduce this first virtual learning opportunity that we're going to have right now through IPA. Seth was gracious enough to be the first one to go. He's got so much expertise. If you guys don't know Seth, Seth is one of the primary instructors for us through Institute of Physical Art. He's got a lot of other things that he's involved with, which I'll let him introduce, but he's also on the board as a member for CFMT and comes to test people for certification in functional manual therapy every year. I'm excited to just learn from him as he's presenting this. I've been playing around with blood flow restriction in the clinic, but I think Seth's going to bring so much knowledge and wisdom. One of the things that we're going to have is with Q&A. If you guys open up the Q&A, there's going to be open questions. I'm going to be doing most of the monitoring of the questions as it goes on. Towards the end of the session is when Seth's going to be able to answer questions. We are going to have this around an hour. Luckily, we're not going to get cut off. If any of you saw me interview my dad on Instagram Live, that got an abrupt cutoff. This won't have an abrupt cutoff like that one. So if we go a few minutes over with questions, that's totally fine. Part of the fun thing that we've got with this is that with the Q&A, you can upvote or down like questions. So if you see questions as attendees that you really want answered, just give them the upvote and we'll probably look to answer those questions a little bit more quickly towards the end when we get to the Q&A session part of this. If anybody has any questions, I'll also be monitoring the chat and you'll get to see, I can comment back in the chat so that everybody can see that. So without further ado, let me, Seth, why don't you introduce yourself, a lot of things you're involved with, and then get going on the presentation. I'm gonna go ahead and mute myself.
All right, perfect. Thanks, Ryan. All right, so thank you guys for joining in. Welcome to those of you who came to this through the IPA and that are part of the IPA family, thanks for joining. And I know there's some other people that may have just had this shared with them from you know, a friend or a colleague. So welcome. Thank you guys for taking the time to do this. I know a lot of us are sitting around wondering what to do with our free time. So thanks for taking advantage of some downtime. So I won't take too much of the time going through introductions, but as Ryan said, I am a PT. I'm on the East Coast. I'm in Northern Virginia. I'm the senior director for a company called Inova, Inova Health System. I've run our outpatient physical therapy centers. So we've got 18 outpatient clinics that I oversee. I still treat patients and spend a good amount of my time in patient care, although not so much the last month or so. I also am gotten pretty involved with our sports medicine program. I'm the PT for the Washington Nationals, as well as for now the Washington Spirit, which is our professional women's soccer team. So I spend a good amount of my time with athletes really of all ages, from youth athletes all the way up. I am, as Ryan said, on faculty with the IPA, so I teach a good amount of courses with the IPA, and we'll kind of reference a couple of those as we go. So what we're going to be talking about tonight is BFR, blood flow restriction therapy, which is a treatment modality that I use a good amount. I've talked about it a good amount in some of my classes. So one of the courses that I teach is called SOP, it stands for Strategies for Optimizing Performance. And I reference BFR in the class, but it's not, we don't really have time to get too in detail with it. Oh, sorry about that. So I can't really get into detail with that. So there's times where we've gotten off on tangents, but I think it's good to be able to have this forum to be able to talk a bit. And the reason this kind of came to me to want to do this was we talk a lot on the Google group. And for those of you involved with the IPA, we exchange ideas and have discussions over the Google group. And Greg's always sending out articles and we post different conversations. And BFR has come up several times. So that's when I reached out to them and said, you want me to give a lecture on it? Something that I use a good amount. So I figured this would be a good opportunity. Tell you a little bit about kind of my background with BFR. So when it was first proposed to me, it was by a physician that I work pretty closely with who treats a lot of athletes. She's been involved in the NFL for a long time. And she asked me if I knew anything about it. And I really didn't at the time, but I said, I'd check it out. I'll tell you, I'm not a gadget person at all. And anytime something new pops up, I'm especially if it's a gadget, I'm probably the most skeptical one in the room and the least likely to jump on board. It's, you know, that new shiny toy that comes out, I'm not so interested in it. So when I heard about BFR, I wasn't a huge fan of it. I'm not a big modality person. So I thought, well, you know, I'd like to learn about different things. I'll go check it out and see what it's all about. But I'm not going to like it. I'll go at least look and see what it's all about. It was funny. I had a conversation with my boss at the time, who's not a clinician. And I said, you know, I'm going to go down to Texas and I'm going to learn about blood flow restriction therapy. And he said, well, that doesn't sound like a good idea. And I said, yeah, I mean, I don't know too much about it, but I would think you want blood flow. So let me go check it out and we'll see what it's all about. So I went down to Texas. This is about 5 years ago now. And I took the class from Johnny Owens, and I'll talk more about Johnny in a few minutes. And what was interesting about the timing of the class when I took it was I actually flew down there on a Friday afternoon to take the class. It's a 2-day class. And on Friday morning, I had just sat for my CSCS exam, which is a certified strength and conditioning specialist. And I only mention that because there's a lot of studying they have to do for that exam, and it's really on a lot of the physiology of exercise and what it's all about. And so all the specific science that happens to our bodies with exercise was kind of fresh in my mind. So that really was a good timing for me to see what was going on. And it just, again, the timing, it made sense because I already had that so fresh in my mind. So I'm going to talk a good amount about BFR. I'm going to go through a slideshow presentation, and then we'll clip in and out of that. I don't want to bore you with PowerPoint too much, but it's a pretty lengthy presentation. So I'm going to share my screen right now. All right. Ryan, can you put yourself on video? Just give me a thumbs up. That works. All right, beautiful.
Yeah, you got it. It's so looking good.
Already talked a little bit about blood flow restriction. There's a bit about my background. So I'm just going to start rolling with it. So as I mentioned, I went and studied this with Johnny Owens. That's me and Johnny down in the right-hand corner. And Johnny is, he's the director of clinical education for the Owens Recovery Institute. So I'll plug that a little bit. His background and where he comes from is he was the chief of human performance optimization at the Center for the Intrepid, which is down in San Antonio, Texas. In addition to being in charge of human performance, he was also in charge of the limb salvage unit. So it's kind of an interesting combination, but he was the one who oversaw the limb salvage. So when all the soldiers would come back from overseas, it had these massive traumas and these wounds that were severely traumatized, they went to the limb salvage unit. So they did everything that they could to save these limbs from these devastating injuries. And what they started to see was that as they were, you know, working to save these limbs, they got to the point where they were able to start exercising them and putting them in braces and exoskeletons and these devices, that the soldiers were so weak that they couldn't even use them. And they started to say, you know what, just cut it off. I'll just take the amputation. And on a limb salvage unit, that's not really the outcome that you want. So that's where they started to look into how could we start exercising these people maybe a little bit sooner. And that's really where some of the their influence in the BFR world came in. Johnny did not invent blood flow restriction. It's been around for a long time, but that's, I think he's really taken it to another level, and they continue to be the leaders in the research world down at the Center for the Intrepid and in physiology labs all over the world. I just put in there some of the pro sports organizations, because if you look on his website, he'll talk about every sports team that is using it, and it's pretty much every pro sport that you can think of is using that. So let's talk a little bit about muscle building. So we know it's hard to put on muscle, right? You don't just exercise and automatically you gain all this muscle. It's hard to put on muscle, and that's intentionally because muscle is metabolically expensive. That means it requires a lot of protein. It requires a lot of calories and nutrients in order to sustain that. So if back in prehistoric days, we put muscle on every time we used our body, we would have a hard time finding enough protein and enough calories to sustain that. So the way that our bodies have kind of been designed is that we only put muscle on when we absolutely need to. Johnny talks a lot about prehistoric days and, you know, when you ran away from a predator, if you were successful, then the body knew, all right, we need to put on more muscle. And then they were able to get some hypertrophy, but we can't do that every time that we exercise, just gain all this muscle. So here's kind of the background thought process as to why BFR is a good option. So the American College of Sports Medicine says that optimizing muscular strength and hypertrophy has to be done at a high enough load, and it has to be done exercising at between 70 to 85% of a one rep max. If we're not exercising at levels that high, we're not actually stressing the muscle enough to have adequate breakdown to get growth of muscle cells. Now, if you think about what happens with our patients, you know, I've got a little picture of some TheraBand exercises in there. We're probably not exercising people at those intensities of 70 to 85% of one rep max. Now, that's not to say that our patients don't get stronger, and we know that our patients get stronger. And for those of you who are from the IPA background, you know, a lot of the strengthening that we do is not so much getting people stronger, it's getting better initiation or activation or integration of our muscles. So we get more motor units kicking in, maybe muscles that had been inhibited, we're able to get them to strengthen, or we get a better representation on the motor homunculus. So we get muscles firing better, but are we actually gaining muscle strength? You know, I tell patients all the time when we're doing PNF and we're trying to facilitate better motor contractions and better firing patterns, that's extremely important to get the right things firing at the right times and turn those muscles on. But we may not be truly gaining strength and getting stronger and truly getting muscle hypertrophy because we probably are not stressing the tissue at the loads that we need to. Now, that's not necessarily because we don't do it. Sometimes we just can't. You know, if somebody recently had surgery, they're a recent post-op, or they're in pain, or they have limited weight-bearing status or poor tissue quality or tissue health, sometimes you just can't load tissues that well. So that's where we start to think about, well, what can we potentially do with them? So here's kind of where we stop and think, well, what if there was a way to have low load training have the same physiological response of the body as high intensity training? So what if we could exercise with lower weight and still get some of these physiologic gains? And we'll get into the science of it in a little while. So what blood flow restriction therapy is we use a tourniquet system to partially occlude arterial blood flow and to completely block venous return. And we'll get into some of the specifics about that. And you exercise with a tourniquet on. It sounds like a terrible idea, but hear me out for a little while. And what all the studies have shown, and there's a lot of studies that have validated this, that blood flow restriction with low load training at about 20 to 30% of a one rep max has been shown to have the same strength and hypertrophy gains as that high intensity training, that 80% of a one rep max. So the combination of vascular occlusion and low level exercise has produced the same results. So in theory, it makes sense. So let's talk a little bit about, you know, what it is and why that is. So if you think about high intensity exercise, what happens when we exercise? We break down tissue in order to trigger synthesis. We want to repair and grow a little bit more. So the net balance that we get is we break some down and then we want to build some up, and we'd like to build up a little bit more than we broke down. So that's really the goal in resistance training, is to be on the positive side of that equation, to build a little bit more than we break down. Okay. So when we look at muscle damage, if we look at using, if we look at exercising with blood flow restriction, we can actually get the same benefits that high intensity training gets, and we can start that protein synthesis, but we don't get that muscle breakdown that we get from high intensity training. And we know that because of measuring some of the levels that happen in our body when we do get muscle breakdown. So if you think about the net balance when we're talking about blood flow restriction, if regular exercise or high intensity exercise, we're breaking this much down, we build it up and a little bit more. The idea with BFR is we're not really having breakdown and we're stimulating that same amount of growth. So we should definitely be on the positive side of that equation. Picture there, that's Jadeveon Clowney. He was one of the first pro athletes to really speak on behalf of BFR. He used it a ton because it really started down in Houston in this wave and through Owens. So he was a big one. Dwight Howard from the Houston Rockets was another big one that you'll see stuff about him. All right. So if you're like me and you're thinking about this, my first thought was really we're using tourniquets to occlude blood flow. Exercising with that on sounds like a terrible idea. And if you're a clinician, the first thing you should be thinking is that really safe? Should I be doing that? So fortunately, it's been researched a good amount. So a couple of the things that we look at are that tourniquets, when they're used for short durations, do not pose any increased risk of thrombus or blood clots. And there have been several studies that have looked at this and actually shown that short bouts of tourniquets actually have thrombolytic potential. So they can actually break down blood clots. So it actually improves circulation. We know that resistance exercise also improves circulation. And this has been done, there have been a lot of studies that have looked at how much is broken down, and there's been shown to be no increased risk of thrombin generation or clot formation after BFR. And I just put two resources in there, but there have been a lot of them that have looked at that. I mentioned where it came from. So it developed on patients in the limb salvage unit. So these were your extremely medically fragile patients, these soldiers that had these mass traumas, and that's who they were using it on. And they've also used this a good amount in the military through the Center for the Intrepid, but also at other locations. And they've had over 5,000 ACLs in a study over 10 years, and there have been zero reports of thrombus. So even though you might be thinking it sounds like it could be a little bit of a risky thing because of blood clots, all the research on it has been great. If we look at some of the cardiac response, and this is an older study, but I think it's still valid. Some of the things that we've seen with high intensity training, especially with extreme Valsalva and increased internal pressures in our bodies, was that at a one rep max, super high intensity training, heart rates can spike as high as 170 beats per minute. And you can see how high blood pressures can get on that slide. But it's been shown that BFR at 20% of a one rep max showed only slightly elevated vitals from heart rate and blood pressure compared to exercise at that low intensity without blood flow restriction. So it does get your heart rate up a little bit. It does get your blood pressure up a little bit, but nowhere near the levels that a Valsalva with extreme blood flow restriction or with extreme heavy exercise would be. So the types of tourniquets that we use, and I'll talk a little bit more about the specific device I use through the Owens Recovery Owens Recovery Science. They're class one medical devices. So tourniquets are FDA regulated devices. There's always a risk when you put a tourniquet on someone, and the biggest risks I put on there are tissue damage and tissue breakdown, skin breakdown, nerve injury. I've never seen it. Those usually occur when you have very high pressures and they're very concentrated into small amounts. You can see the tourniquets that I have on the screen, those are pretty wide. So we're able to spread out the force so it's not so compressed and squeezing in small amounts of tissue. So it increases the surface area, so we decrease the need for occlusion. That's called the Delphi system that we use. It is the only FDA approved one. But what I really like about it is it's the only one that truly measures limb occlusion pressure. And I'll show you some pictures of that in a little while. We put it on and it actually measures the amount of pressure like a blood pressure cuff would do. And then it will address how hard it's squeezing throughout the exercise based on someone's blood pressure and body type. And again, it's the only one that measures that limb occlusion pressure. So what gets scary about BFR is you'll see all types of knockoffs and all types of other devices. And if you put on, you know, BFR bands on Amazon, you can find things for, you know, $20 that you can wrap on tightly around your body and theoretically use BFR. None of those, as you can see, measure anything. There are some other ones that do measure and that measure millimeters of mercury like a blood pressure cuff would, but it's not measuring limb occlusion pressures. Some of those are just based on subjective amounts of pressure. You know, they'll tell someone to put it on until it's tight. But if you're doing that and you're not truly measuring how much it's occluding, then you can't really claim any of the science behind all the research, because the research has been done on different levels of occlusion pressure. And the protocols that I'll talk about are the ones that have shown to be the most valid and the most effective. So if all you're doing is putting something on that's tight, you can't really, again, claim any of the benefits. What you'll see too on these is they're much narrower cuffs that most people use. If you see bodybuilders using it, if you have a narrow cuff, in order to provide the same occlusion, you have to squeeze it a lot tighter. So that's where you get into the risk factors of nerve injury and tissue breakdown. But if you could spread that out a little bit more, then you've got much less potential for tissue damage. So some of these are pretty straightforward, but anytime you're talking about blood flow restriction, you want to talk about what some of the risks are. These are really common sense, I think, for most people, but if somebody has a poor circulatory system, and you can read through those and see what some of the key risk factors are for that. The contraindications, these are pretty much common sense. You're not going to restrict blood flow if somebody already has a clot, if they have a dialysis port or an infection or fracture. This should really be common sense for most people. All right, so let's talk a little bit about why BFR works and why it's effective. So the recommendation that hypertrophy requires a high enough load, as I mentioned, it's not about the load. What it actually is, it's a recommendation that we have to get into anaerobic metabolism. That's really what triggers all the physiologic responses in the body. And there's a lot of different theories as to why. So now we're gonna get into a little bit of the science. So for the therapists on this, hopefully this will make some sense. If you're not a therapist, just be prepared for a little bit of science over the next several slides. But I wanna talk about why this works, and we'll get into these four different theories as we go. So the first one, which I think makes the most sense, is the metabolite theory. So basically what's happening when you exercise, you're limiting oxygen supply to the muscle, we switch over to an anaerobic state. So you don't need to get into, you know, specific cycles that we're doing, but we exercise, we get toxins that build up in the muscle. So we get lactate and we get hydrogen ions. People think about lactic acid and that muscle burn that we get. So what actually happens with that muscle burn is that stimulates the release of growth factors. Okay, so if you're exercising hard enough, you get that muscle burn, your body knows that it has to grow, triggers the pituitary to release growth hormone. Now, what we found was that BFR uses the same principles. So by limiting the available oxygen, because without having the same mechanical stress, we get the same responses. So let's talk a little bit more about this. So you get that lactic acid that builds up, triggers release of growth hormone and what we call a growth hormone spike. There have been a lot of studies that look at this. This is one by Takarada, which is kind of a well-known one in the BFR world, that showed that after exercise with just high intensity exercise, so heavy loads, you get a 1.7 or 170% increase in the growth hormone in the body. When you exercise at low intensity levels with blood flow restriction, you get a 2.9% or 290% increase in baseline. So we get this spike of growth hormone, and we're not actually having that same tissue damage. Now, low intensity training without BFR, you don't get any spike in human growth hormone. So what does growth hormone do? Well, there's some thoughts that it might not actually be what triggers protein synthesis and hypertrophy. It may actually serve a little bit more of a role in the recovery process and promoting some repair of collagen. So we'll talk more about recovery in a little while. So basically what happens, we get that BFR that stimulates the release of your growth hormone. We know that that can help with collagen synthesis, and then growth hormone stimulates the release of, it's called IGF-1 or insulin-like growth factor, and that's been shown to increase strength and hypertrophy. So in summary, with this metabolite theory is, you exercise with blood flow restriction on, you get all this lactic acid that builds up, triggers a release of growth hormone, triggers a release of IGF, then you get your strength and hypertrophy gains. The next one is the muscle activation theory. And that's for any of you that do a lot of prolonged holds, you know, again, for the IPA community, if you're having people exercise and you're doing prolonged holds, what we know that we're doing when we hold an exercise, we're getting more and more motor units kicking in, right? And whether we're looking at temporal summation or what we're trying to accomplish, we're getting more motor units to kick in the longer that we hold an exercise. So as lactate builds up and as you're exercising and you build up more and more lactate under blood flow restriction conditions, and you need to maintain that force, you have to turn on more and more motor units. So I like this study that was listed here. It showed that in standard exercise with TheraBand, if you're just doing regular TheraBand exercises on the bicep, you're only triggering about 23% of the motor units of the bicep muscle to actually work. With tricep extensions, it was only about 12%. You did the same TheraBand exercise under BFR conditions, you can see the numbers. It shot up to 69% and 45%. So we get a lot more motor units kicking in, so you can theoretically strengthen a lot more of the tissues. The next theory that I have on here is myostatin. So myostatin, that's called a Belgian blue cow. It's a pretty interesting looking creature that does not have myostatin. And myostatin is a protein in our body that actually prohibits us from putting on muscle. Like I said, we couldn't always put on muscle every time we exercise because the body wouldn't be able to sustain it. So what we try to do when we exercise, what happens is that myostatin is slightly suppressed. We want to down-regulate our myostatin in order to put on muscle. Okay, if we're able to down-regulate that, then we're able to actually hypertrophy muscle. So what we've seen in a lot of the BFR literature is that downregulation of myostatin, well, first under heavy lifting conditions, after only 9 weeks, you get a downregulation of about 85% of the myostatin, so you're able to hypertrophy. Now, under BFR conditions, BFR at 20% of one rep max also demonstrated similar downregulation as heavy lifting. So you can see it was actually even a little bit better in this study by Laurentino, that downregulating that myostatin allowed us to be able to hypertrophy muscle. The next theory on here is cell swelling. And that's what we look at with cellular swelling is if we bring more fluid into the cell, we don't want our cells to burst. So we have to build up those cells and build protein so that we can reinforce that cell membrane so that it's not going to burst. And we know that when we exercise, we get some amount of swelling, but cell swelling turns on protein synthesis. And what happens in BFR conditions is we actually bring more blood into that area, into those cells, the cells swell, so we need to build some protein. This is a pretty surprising study. So what this one looked at was putting BFR on patients after an ACL and not even having them exercise, just putting it on as they laid on the table twice a week, two times a day for 12 days. And what they found was that those patients that did not have any BFR on, that just laid on the table, had a decreased cross-sectional size of their quads by about 20%. Those that had laid on the table and just had BFR on and didn't even exercise had much less atrophy. So BFR, even without exercise, reduces atrophy. So we know that cell swelling alone can help decrease the atrophy. They show that within 2 weeks of complete immobilization of the leg, if someone is non-weight-bearing, you just put them on the put them in bed and they were not able to do anything, our protein synthesis drops down by about 30%. We get about a 30% decrease in strength just after 2 weeks. By putting BFR and doing just simple table exercises over those 2 weeks of being immobilized, they had an average strength loss of only 5%. This is an interesting study that looked at some muscle wasting. So it looked at a 65-year-old male with idiopathic myositis, so had a muscle wasting disease, had therapy for over a year, was down to an assistive device, strength and size of his quads just continued to decrease over the years. He was put on a BFR program at 20% of a one rep max twice a week for 12 weeks and put on some exercises, such stands for leg press, knee extensions, and partial squats. After, you can see the results on that. After 12 weeks, he had a significant increase in his leg press strength and his timed up and go, it improved by 60%. And his circumference actually increased of his thigh by almost 5%. So this is somebody with a muscle wasting disease that was still able to gain muscle. And what was interesting about this one was after 10 weeks of not doing anything, he maintained his strength. So we'll talk a little bit about some other potential implications of BFR. So we know that tendons, especially tendons when they are damaged, they need a load on them for collagen synthesis. When we have injured tendons, whether it's a partial tear or, you know, just poor tissue quality, we can't really load them like we would like to. So at times we might want to do something like BFR to be able to increase the load on the tendon without actually stressing it with increased weight. As far as bone density goes, growth hormone has been shown to impact collagen synthesis with bone. So it actually can stimulate some bone growth. We know in patients that have osteopenia, they've been shown to have lower levels of growth hormone and that insulin growth factor. So increasing these from BFR can hopefully increase some bone density. And there have been several studies that looked at that. You know, we know bone lays down more bone cells in response to stress. And that's not just stress in weight bearing, but it's also stress of muscles pulling on bone. So the more we're able to strengthen and actually get muscles firing, the more bone density we were able to have. And there's a study by Hewitt that showed that. So if we're doing a lot of things to stress the body, one thing that we need to tell our patients is you need to have proper nutrition after this. And I always tell patients when we're doing this in the clinic, I ask them, first of all, have you eaten recently? And when we're done, make sure you get a good meal and you especially some protein shortly after, ideally within about 30 minutes of having exercised. So we'll talk a little bit about the cardiac response. There have been shown to have some several benefits as far as cardiovascular benefits with BFR. We know that our cardiac output, so what how our heart is working, remains constant. And that's equal to the stroke volume, how much blood we're pumping, times our heart rate. So if BFR, we have more blood that's in the extremity, so less that the heart is actually pumping. So the stroke volume goes down. So that causes the heart rate to elevate. So we know that you're basically getting a cardiovascular benefit from exercising with BFR. Show a couple quick studies on this. This took healthy collegiate athletes and showed BFR cycling. So putting it on and doing exercise bike for 15 minutes actually showed a significant increase in VO2 max. We saw the same thing. This was with a group of college basketball players that had them just walking on a treadmill under BFR conditions. And in 2 weeks, they increased their VO2 max by 11%. We do see proximal and distal gains. So I'll show you some pictures on this. When we put the cuffs on, we only put them on the proximal upper extremity or proximal lower extremity. So you think, well, what about those muscles, the trunk muscles? What about things that are proximal to those cuffs? Well, this study that I quoted here by Yasuda showed that they put BFR on the upper thigh and had people do squats and leg curls. And what they found was that the BFR group actually not only increased their squat strength and their leg curl, but they had significant increase in muscle volume of not only their quads and their glutes, their quads and their hamstrings, which you would expect, but also their glutes, which are proximal. So we know that we get systemic gains because you're getting this growth hormone that's going throughout your body. This is one of the most fascinating studies, I think, for BFR. And it took two groups, and it had two groups do low intensity, 50% one rep max, bicep curls. None of them had BFR on their biceps. So two different groups are doing bicep curls. Then they had them both do leg flexion and extension at 30% of their one rep max, one group with BFR and the other without BFR. And what they showed was that the group that were doing the leg exercises with BFR actually had more of a significant hypertrophy of their biceps. So again, you get the systemic gains, you're getting growth hormone that's going throughout your body. All right, so that's a lot of talking about the science behind it. Let's talk about how it's done and then some of the clinical applications. So this is the older version of the Delphi unit that we use. So we put a cuff on the proximal upper or lower extremity, and then we measure that limb occlusion pressure, and then we're calculating the percentage that we want to work at. Okay, so we inflate the cuff, and for the lower extremity, the research has shown the best results are exercising at 80% of arterial occlusion. So that means we're occluding 80% of arterial blood flow going to the limb and 100% of the venous return. And we're doing four sets of exercise. We do 30 reps, then three sets of 15 with a 30-second rest in between. But the rest isn't really a rest, because if you think about normal exercise, you know, you do 30 reps, you're fatigued, you let the limb relax, you walk around a little bit, you're recovered, then you go in and do your second set. Well, when the cuff is on and it's inflated, you do your 30 seconds, you get this blood that's flowing into the leg in this case, your 30-second rest, it doesn't let go, so it's still squeezing. Then you go into a set of 15, a 30-second rest, another set, and we do four sets like that. And by the end, you're pretty exhausted because you haven't had that break that you would normally get between sets. So as I mentioned, the lower extremity, we work at 80% of arterial, 100% of venous. The upper extremity, we work at 50% of arterial restriction. And this is me doing it on a leg press machine. You can really do it on any exercise. So a lot of times we'll start off early on in rehab doing simple table exercises, your quad sets, your bridges, leg raises, things like that. And then you can progress to really any exercise that you can think of. All right, so I'm gonna see if this works. I'm gonna stop sharing for just a second. Let me go back to here. Okay. Ryan, can you guys see that?
Yep, it's okay. Working.
So this is it, me in the clinic doing some step-ups. So I'm just going to play this. It's not that fascinating of a video. It's just seeing step-ups. But you can see the cuff is on while I'm doing exercise. And what I want to draw you to is if you look at the device up here, you can see that that's the limb occlusion pressure, and it's changing as the exercise goes. So it's not just put it on tight and keep it tight. We need to make sure that we continue to change so that we can keep that 80% occlusion. And that will change when you're in a different position or when you're doing different things. So it's not just, like I said, some of the other devices will just put it on tight and then you just exercise. You're not really staying at that same intensity. Okay, so I'm gonna stop that. All right, we back?
Yep, you're back on. You got the presentation up. Perfect.
Beautiful. Okay. All right, so let's talk a little bit about the protocols and how we would do it. So most of the research has shown doing it 2 to 3 times a week at about a 30% of a 1 rep max. You can do it every day, and I've had plenty of athletes that I work with when I'm fortunate enough to deal with pro athletes that I can see every day. I've done plenty of them where we use this every single day. We might change the exercises up each time, not do the same thing every day, but it can be done that frequently. It can continue throughout your entire plan of care. So if you're seeing somebody for, you know, several months, you can continue with it, but you get the most visible changes in those first 4 weeks. What Johnny talks about a lot is it's really used as a gateway to heavy lifting. So I know people think like, oh, this is, you know, this is a great exercise. Why don't I just put this on and do heavy lifting?
Can you hear me, Seth?
Oh, no. Yeah, I got you, Ryan. Sorry.
I'm interrupting. I got like a number of people who say that they've lost the video or the presentation. Do you mind just like minimizing it again and then trying to reshare the screen, just see if that brings it back for everybody?
I'm going to stop share.
Thanks.
All right. Sorry about that.
No, I don't think it was anything. Oh, we got a couple that said fix, so they got your video. Let's try sharing again and see if that works.
Okay. This we're going to share screen.
Thanks Allison and Brian and everybody for saying that.
All right, we good?
I'll let you know if I get comments. I'll interrupt again, but I think a couple people said that it was better.
Okay, sorry about that. All right, so as I was saying, sorry if you missed this, you can do this 2 to 3 times a week and in more of a traditional clinic setting. If you get to see people every day, it could be done every day. We can do it throughout the course of treatment. But as I was saying down on that fourth bullet, it's really used as a gateway to heavy lifting. So a lot of people think that if you're exercising at low intensity and you're getting this much gains and now I can get to heavy lifting, well, wouldn't it be that much better if I could do heavy lifting with BFR? Well, it really hasn't been shown to give a lot of additional benefit to do heavy lifting with it. So in general, I tell people, if you can lift heavy, then lift heavy. You don't need to have BFR with heavy lifting.
Hey, Seth, We're still having issues. Sorry to interrupt, man.
That's right. What do you want me to do? You want me to stop share?
Yeah, can we stop sharing your screen? I think that brings it back for everybody. A couple people said there's fixed, but then some other people said that they're still having issues.
Okay. All right.
Let's give it a 15-second break. For those of you, if you leave and re-enter, I think a number of people got that fixed. We'll take like a 20-second break. If a couple of you who are struggling to see the thing want to just leave and re-enter, we'll start presenting. Thanks for pausing, Seth.
Yeah, no problem. Thanks for
presentation so far.
And cutting me off.
No, we've got a lot of good questions that people have been bringing up. I'm excited to get to them at the end of the presentation. Okay. For those of you who haven't left any questions, if you have any, just add them up to that queue of Q&A, and we'll get to those at the end. So, and if you're raising your hand, I know a couple of you have raised hands. If you have a question, go ahead and add it to the list of Q&A. If you look down at the bottom, there's Q&A. Add it to there, and that'll help us organize which ones we get to at the end. All right, Seth, why don't you go again?
Let's see our screen again.
Yeah, go again and let's see what happens. Fingers crossed.
See what type of comments you're getting. We back on?
Yeah, I'll keep track of it.
All right. All right, that worked.
Yeah, it's looking like a number of people got it. Why don't you just keep going? Good thing is we're gonna find a way to have this available at the end so people can, they'll be able to view it later if they're struggling now. I think they should stick in and still listen so they can ask questions and be a part of the interaction at the end.
Got it. All right, so sorry if you can't see me or can't see the slides. There's only a few more, so we'll be able to get off of the screen share in a few minutes. All right, so let me go back here. All right, so talk a little bit about clinical applications and when it's used, what types of patients do we use it on, what's it look like in the clinic. So for me, if I have a post-op surgical patient for an extremity, it's a no-brainer. I'm going to use that pretty much every time because I can start strengthening them so much sooner. Now, this doesn't take away from any of my manual therapy work that I'm doing or facilitation or any of my hands-on, my PNF. I'm basically using all that to, you know, to train how I want the muscles to work. And then when I want to just start doing strengthening, that's when I can jump right in and start using the BFR. So post-ops, it's a no-brainer. You can see somebody here with a external fixator on. And anytime that I really want to minimize the stress to a tissue, if there's poor tissue health, if I'm worried about how much someone's training, you know, for example, I had a baseball player that I was talking with recently about it, and he doesn't use his legs all that well, and he doesn't feel like he's got great leg strength because he says he can't really exercise his legs. He doesn't want to squat because he's worried about his back. So we could do tons of squats and low load, like goblet squats, things where we don't have to load his body up under BFR and get the same strength gains that we would get from doing heavy loaded squats. I put in there patient training load concerns too. You know, I talked with another pitcher, this is last season, that we were doing a lot of just basic shoulder work and rotator cuff work and doing it under BFR conditions. He was getting so much more out of it. He said, well, why don't I just do this during the season so I'm not stressing my cuff as much? So I thought, you know, that's a great plan. Why don't we do that? So anybody that you're really trying to accelerate hypertrophy, I had a patient not too long ago who came in to the clinic and he had had an Achilles repair almost a year ago and still had so much atrophy. So we really kind of jump-started that hypertrophy phase again by just getting him on BFR a couple times a week. And he was really able to pick up strength pretty quickly. How we doing, Brian? Everything good?
Yeah, you're good. I think there's still a few people who are struggling on seeing it, but honestly, if they just stick with it so that they can ask questions and hear the questions and answers, we're going to post the presentation so that they'll be able to view it later so they can catch the slides later.
Okay, sounds good. Because I know there's, oh, sorry. Let me go back up. I know there's a lot of you that are pretty well versed in the IPA. You know, we talk about our different treatment pillars that we focus on, our mechanical, our neuromuscular, and our motor control. Within that neuromuscular pillar, we really work on initiating the right contractions of the muscle and then actually strengthening those muscles. So for me, this falls right into that neuromuscular pillar. I've had patients that have come in that really were not able to fire, let's say, a quad very well. And I've done everything that I know how to do manually and trying to facilitate and get good responses and can get a little bit of a better contraction. But then I've put them on BFR and start doing quad sets. And by the end of it, you can actually see that quad finally start firing. So then I might go back and do a little bit more of my manual therapy. So using it to initiate appropriate muscles, it has been great. And then obviously once things are firing, just building strength or building endurance, like I talked about before, works really well. I won't get too much into this, but we're starting to see athletes, especially professional athletes, use this a good amount for recovery. You know, when people ask me what they should do for recovery, and most of the theory is you want to promote circulation, right? Whether that means you get in a contrast tub and you do hot, cold, or you get soft tissue work done and you're going for, you know, a massage or a flush or some type of compression or e-stim that pumps it. With this, all we're trying to do is get improved circulation and pump blood throughout the system. So if the goal is to improve circulation and enhance blood flow, we can do it with BFR also. So what we've started to do is have athletes after playing, after being fatigued, after a run, whatever, just come in and put the BFR on and do some basic exercises. And when you take that off, you get such a flush going throughout the system that I think it flushes far better than any of those other options. So something that we're starting to play around with. There's not research on that I'm aware of yet. I've done it for myself when I've done a lot of running and been fatigued and done it with some athletes and have had some pretty good subjective responses so far. So I like to put this one, how does it feel? It doesn't feel good. It's challenging. So you have to have proper patient selection. In general, it feels like you've had a pretty intense workout. I've been sworn at plenty of times. It's challenging. I put the cell phone on there because Johnny Owens, when he talks about how hard should an exercise be, he says if somebody's doing a BFR exercise and they can be texting or they can be on social media, then they're not doing it hard enough. So that's when we know we've got to increase that amount of load. And you really want to get to the point where you're at extreme fatigue. So the goal is by the end of those four sets, you've gotten to that point of almost muscle failure, almost kind of extreme fatigue. If you haven't gotten to that after the four sets, then you probably need to bump the load up a little bit. So patient selection, if you're treating that couch potato who's not used to exercising and doesn't like the idea of working out, probably not going to be a great candidate for it. But when you get that motivated patient or that person that's not afraid of a little muscle burn and wants to really push themselves, they love it. They do really, really well with it. All right. So that's, as I mentioned, I am with the Nats. So that one of my favorite pictures, got to hold the World Series trophy back a few months back. I also put some of my contact information on there. That's my email. That's me on Instagram. So if you're interested or want to send a message or ask questions, I'm happy to take that. And I will turn it over to Ryan and we can hit some questions.
There's a bunch of questions here. I dismissed a few that there might have been answers to earlier in the presentation. So just okay, so people know I can even go in and type out answers to some of those that got dismissed. Probably not going to get through all of these, but there's some really, really interesting ones. Sure. Let's go with this one. Well, this is from Timothy at BUI. I'm not going to pronounce that correctly, so sorry. he said, great presentation. If the patient has a denervated nerve, would it be possible to use e-stim in tandem with the blood flow restriction to help recruit those muscle fibers? And is it possible to use Russian stim with BFR?
Yes, it is, both of them. And I've used it with not necessarily a denervated nerve, but that's not true. I have tried it on that. But patients post-op, like let's say you get that ACL patient who's quad you just cannot get to fire, and you put some Russian stim on or some different types of NMES and you get a better contraction with it, you can absolutely do BFR in addition to it and at the same time. There have been times where, you know, I've done some NMES and got a better contraction. I've done some stim, BFR and got a better contraction. And if I'm trying to decide which one actually worked better for this patient, we'll just do them both. I think I've definitely seen a good response in having them both at the same time. So you definitely can do that.
Here's another one. And there were a couple of questions just post-op. I know that you were talking about using it post-op. And I'm going to try to hit a few of them that I just saw. Anything with swelling, do you see? I know that you hit at the beginning with DVTs. You're not seeing as much thrombosis as some people are worried about. And so those were some of the questions that I dismissed.
Yep.
But what about just general swelling? Are you seeing increase or decrease in general swelling after doing this? Are you worried about that?
So that's a great question. While it's on, you get a lot of blood going to the area, but because when you take it off, you get such a flush, I think it actually helps to decrease swelling. Now, if I have a hot and red joint coming in, I'm probably not going to do it. But in general, I'm not afraid of a little bit of swelling after surgery, because I think when you take that off, just like I was talking about with the recovery, you get a very good flush. The only thing I really pay close attention to after surgery is wound closure. So obviously the wound needs to be closed. You're bringing a lot more blood to the area. So if a wound looks like it's going to burst open any second, then you don't necessarily want to put that much pressure on it. So as long as the wound is closed, then I'm comfortable doing it. So for something like an ACL, maybe it's a week. For if you're talking about a total joint, a total knee, we might be, waiting 2 weeks. I've put it on early on. If it's a shoulder, let's say it's a shoulder surgery, there's no reason I can't put it on distal to that very early on and just promote some circulation and some exercise throughout the rest of the extremity.
Great. Here's another question. How cautious are you with using blood flow restriction in patients with like hot nerves, or let's say an upper extremity like thoracic outlet syndrome? Have you played around with that with any of your pitchers or any athletes?
Yeah, I have. And it's funny that question, I don't know if this is why it came up, but there was a well-known PT who works a lot in the baseball world who put a post out just last year that he doesn't believe in doing BFR for his pitchers for their arms because he's too worried about nerve compression. And it was funny, as soon as I heard that, I was texting with Johnny and he said, oh, my phone was blowing up for like that whole week. And my comment on that is I have treated a lot of pitchers that have nerve restrictions down the arm. But I would say almost all of them, their restrictions are more in the cervical spine. You know, if it's truly a thoracic outlet, I'm not compressing anything here. I'm compressing here. So I'm not really worried about that so much. Now, if we're talking about, a distal nerve entrapment, that might be a different story. But for thoracic outlet type symptoms, I'm not as concerned as long as there's not bound out restrictions distal to there.
Okay. So just clinically, even if you have somebody who's getting ridiculous symptoms, are you avoiding this or are you willing to do some strengthening? Does it depend? Is it variable?
I'd be willing to do it. It's probably not my priority for their treatment. I mean, my goal is to clear up ridiculous symptoms, and I'm probably doing a lot more manual treatment and trying to free up all the soft tissues and get nerve mobility and joint mobility back so that they're not having these ridiculous symptoms. So I can't say that somebody comes in with ridiculous symptoms, my goal is let's strengthen them. So I wouldn't shy away from it, but it's probably not my focus on treatment.
Excellent. Here's another like post-medical intervention. Have you seen anybody who's like post-PRP, post-stem cell injections? What's the recommendation for any of those types?
Yeah, and I get to work pretty closely with several physicians, and we've talked about this a good amount. And in general, we've both done some research on both of our ends. I'll wait about 2 weeks before I do it if somebody's had an injection, just because I don't want to flush everything out of there. I don't know if that's truly what's going to happen anyway, but when I've talked to physicians and they've asked some of their colleagues, they've all been at kind of on the same line that let's not do it right away, but if you give it a couple of weeks to really let that soak in, then we can start doing it.
There's a couple I'm trying to scan as quickly as I can through everything. There's a number of people who are asking about upper and lower age limits. I know you had sort of briefly touched that you're willing to do it on most patients, but do you have anything that guides you in your determination on if somebody's either too young or too old for it?
Yeah, I'll say on the younger side of it first, the youngest person that I think I've done it on has probably been, I'd say 10 or 11, around there. One is you need good compliance. I mean, they need to understand what you're doing and be willing to push through some discomfort with an exercise. You know, it's not going to feel great. So, you know, understanding that they can tough it out and they can push through. And, you know, if you get that, you know, 10, 11, 12 year old athlete that's super motivated, then I'd be fine doing it. And there's no contraindication as far as anything physiologically why you couldn't do it with them. For an older population, I go back to those risk factors. And as long as they are medically clear and they have no other risk factors, their circulation's fine, their kidneys are fine. We've done it with people in their 70s. I don't think I've gone 80s, but I've talked to Johnny about some people that he's done it with that are considerably older, but definitely, you know, total joints, we've done it a good amount with. So I would say that's about the max that I've done it. Can be done higher, but again, you want to make sure that they don't have any of the other risk factors involved.
Got it. What about somebody early on asked about diminishing returns with, there's a couple asking about diminishing returns with growth factor, or all of the different things as the person ages and there's a decline in those. Are you seeing diminishing returns, but yet still better than not using it? Or
yeah, I would absolutely say that. Yeah, you might not see, you know, that 60-year-old respond the same way the 20-year-old responds, but you definitely see progress with them. So it's you're not really comparing that 60-year-old to that 20-year-old, but you're comparing the 60-year-old with BFR to where they would be without BFR. So in that case, you're still seeing benefits. It might not be the same benefit. But yeah, you definitely still see benefits. And that, where I thought you were going with diminishing returns is you definitely get benefits with a given exercise. So let's say I'm starting off and I'm doing, you know, I'm doing bridges with somebody and we're doing a lot of hamstring work. And we've done that for maybe a week or two. It's just like any other exercise. I'm not going to continue with the same exercise. Then I'm going to progress it. Maybe I'm doing, you know, some single leg work, or I'm doing some RDLs or hip thrusters or something where I'm continuing to challenge the muscle. So just like you would progress exercise with anybody, you can progress the exercises that you're doing with BFR the same way that you would with anything else, just probably lower load than you would normally do.
Excellent. A number of people had in their questions, it's just asking about the 30, 15, 15, 15 reps. Are you pretty consistent sticking with that? Do you ever vary it up? Is that just and is there rationale behind why those numbers were chosen for the research? I mean, you know, we always talk about you got to research something. So,
right. Yeah, there's, and I'm sorry, I'm not gonna be able to cite all the studies, but there's a bunch of them. Can you still hear me, Ryan? You froze.
I can still hear you. Yeah.
Okay. There's a bunch of studies that looked at different set and rep parameters. And what they just found was that was the sequence that had the best results. So they had researched a whole bunch of them and found that 30 and then three sets of 15 worked the best. Now, not everybody goes through 30 and then three of 15. Like I said before, your goal is get to the point of muscle fatigue and really you're getting to the point of exhaustion. You know, so if I'm doing something and maybe I grabbed a weight that was too heavy and by the second set, I can't do it anymore, then I'm dropping that weight down. And if I get to that fourth set and I'm doing only body weight now, and by rep number five, I'm done. Well, I've met my goal. So it's not that you have to hit that many reps. The goal is by the time you get to that last set, you almost don't have anything left. And if you got through that 30 and then three of 15, and I'm still carrying on that conversation, I'm on my cell phone and I'm feeling fine, then next time I probably have to go a little heavier. So you think about it more as the goal being to get to that point of near muscle failure?
Couple questions on pressures, which is a great question. Is what's the rationale for the differences again between upper extremity pressure and why it's different than lower extremity pressure? And then also, are there any time, are you always adhering to the pressure recommendations, or are there any times that you vary the amount of pressure that you're doing, and what might be some of the clinical reasons that you're using for anything that's a variance from the norm?
Yeah, so it's a good question. So the general guidelines, as far as what's been researched the most, as I said, on the lower extremity is 80% arterial occlusion, 100% venous return. So you're getting some blood going in, nothing's coming out of the extremity. For the upper, it's 50%. So 50% of the blood going to the arm is restricted, 100% of venous return. The biggest issue with that is on the upper thigh, you have a lot more tissue, so you can squeeze a lot harder. If you put it on 80% on the upper arm, some neurovascular compression and some tissue compression that you don't want to have. So you can't squeeze quite, I've done it that hard, but you don't want to squeeze as hard on the upper extremity and just risk any type of tissue damage or nerve damage just from having compression on it. As far as your other question about do I vary it, not for a specific patient population, but there have been...
Can I interrupt you for a second and just follow up with that, and then we'll go ahead. To varying
yeah,
it?
Yeah, go ahead. Yeah.
And your videos, the audio was cutting a little bit in and out, so anyways, we'll just give it a pause for a second, see if your internet speeds up. But if you have somebody with a very thin lower extremity, very petite individual, would you consider lowering the pressure even though it's still their lower extremity, since it may be more akin to an upper extremity of some other person, or are you still feeling pretty confident with the amount of pressure that you would put down there?
You know, I'm still feeling pretty confident that they, relatively, they still have a good amount of tissue that I can still compress. Now, the time that I will drop it down, and I have dropped it down with several people, is really just based on patient feedback. If somebody says, I can't take that, that's too tight, well, then I'll drop it down a little bit. Or if I'm seeing that we're getting to 80% and somebody just is really not tolerating it well, rather than just bang it and say, we're not going to do it, then yeah, I think you can still get some benefit of doing it at a lower limb occlusion pressure, but not actually taking it off. So I might drop that down a bit.
Excellent. Now go on to times that you would possibly vary it up. Or is that all that you were going to say?
Yeah, no, that's when I would vary it up, just based on patient response. And if they were having discomfort, they were in pain, they just weren't tolerating it well.
Got it. This question I really like. I don't know if there's going to be any evidence on this. And it's just one of the things sometimes the answer can be you don't know.
Okay.
But do you know if there's certain muscle fiber types that are being most impacted by this? Like, does it make a difference on, you know, whether or not, which muscle fiber types you're getting hypertrophy most with, or?
You know, if we're talking fast twitch, slow twitch, things like that, or type one, type two, I'm sure talking to Johnny about this is kind of mind blowing. He's one of those people that he would answer with like 10 studies that are currently going on around the world. So I apologize that I can't do that. I'll talk, you know, based on my results, on the lower extremities, the muscles that I've seen the best results, quads and hamstrings, it's fantastic for. Gastroc, I've seen excellent results with that. Upper extremity, I mean, anything distal to the arm, that I've seen great results with it. You know, I should mention, Ryan, because you asked this about PRP a while back. So I happened to tear my extensor tendon in my forearm, I don't know, 4 or 5 years ago now. Got a PRP in it and eventually recovered, but it took me about, I'd say, 6 months of being miserable, that I was really hurting. And I had talked to Johnny about it, and I asked him, do you ever use it after PRP? And he said, yeah, he's starting to play around with it. Well, as kind of dumb luck would have it, 2 years later, I tore the same tendon in my left arm. And I actually had a PRP, and I started doing BFR right away. And I'm my own case study N of one. But I will tell you, my left side recovered in about 3 months, whereas my right took probably double that. That is not a publishable case study, but I'm definitely a believer in that.
That's good. And I mean, obviously, if you're using it on yourself and willing to go out there, it's something that you believe in. And also post PRP, have you done it on anybody post stem cell, or is that I missed that. If I missed you answer that, it was because I was glancing through.
I'm trying to think, not just post stem cell. You know, some of the things that happen when you deal a lot with professional athletes is you might throw the kitchen sink at them. So they might get stem cells, but they also had, you know, multiple other things. So I can't say that I've done it just with someone after stem cell. Maybe they had a surgical procedure, or they had their knee drained and then had stem cells injected, or they had, you know, multiple other factors coming in. So I can't say that I've done it as, you know, that controlled of an observation on just stem cells.
Excellent. Let's hit a couple more questions as long as you're good to go. I know we're...
Keep going, I'm fine.
We're a little bit over, so as long as people want to stay on here and keep listening to a few more questions, Seth and I will keep having a discussion back and forth and fielding the questions. Since you love PNF, and I know that you love PNF, do you ever use BFR with PNF?
So yes, I have played around with that, and I can't say that it's been my go-to, but I have done, you know, if I'm doing manual resistance, like let's say I'm doing, you know, some component of an upper extremity manual resistance, where instead of, you know, giving them a dumbbell or a band or a weight, I'm providing that resistance. So absolutely, I've done that through manually resisted exercises. And in that case, I can't say that I'm going for, you know, the same sets and reps of it, but I'm definitely going to the point where we get to tissue fatigue. So yeah, I absolutely can couple it with manual resistance instead of traditional weight or band.
Excellent. Hormone changes. Any research? And once again, I know I'm throwing a bunch at you to try to get off the top of your head, but do you know how long the hormone changes last? Is this something that could last a couple of days, or is this?
Yes. Actually, I know there were a lot of slides in there. I took some out from my last presentation. And one of them was about that. So I don't remember offhand, but there was a study that I had in there that looked at just doing leg extension machine. And what they found that there was after, I think it was after 2 hours, what the growth hormone spike was, what it was after 6 hours, and what it was after 24 hours. And it was still at, it wasn't at that, you know, 2.9%, but I think it was down to like a 1.5% or something like that after 24 hours. So I think you're getting it throughout your system, that systemic response, for at least 24 hours.
That's great. All right. That's pretty nice.
Yeah.
When you were doing it on yourself, this isn't a question, but when you were doing it on yourself, how many times a week were you doing it?
So my plan was I was going to do it 2 to 3 times a week. And, you know, as PTs, patients, and you always have other things get in the way. I would probably say I was once a week. I have units right in my office and I couldn't find the time to put it on. So I would say I probably did once a week I think I probably did it consistently for about 6 weeks or so. And I was just doing wrist extensions. I was doing gripping activities. I was just doing simple exercises, forearm exercises. I was using a web and doing finger extensions with it. I would say that I was closer to once a week.
Let's talk about a little bit of how long, what's like, how long do you leave the cuff on total? Or like, what's your thought on that?
Yeah, so in general, the way that the machines, at least the Delphi unit that I use, the way that it's set up for safety is it's got an 8-minute shutoff. Now, if you go through those 4 sets, that progression, in most cases, most exercises are gonna take you like probably five minutes to get through that. So if that's the case, after that 5 minutes,
Seth, you paused, or at least
we deflate it. And I wouldn't.
Hey, Seth.
Yep.
Sorry, missed the second half of that. You said after those like 5 minutes, you deflate it and then.
So after those 5 minutes, you deflate it. It automatically is built in that there's a 1 minute rest period. So you get your blood flow back, then you can go right into doing another exercise. So I would never, and the machine will shut off at 8 minutes. So in general, if you think that an exercise takes 5 minutes to get through that progression, I'll probably go 5 minutes, take your minute rest, might do a different exercise for 5 minutes, take a minute rest. The most that I've done, I think in general, is about three exercises. I'll usually average 2 to 3 exercises. So they're occluded for a total of about 10 to maybe max of 15 minutes, but that's not straight. There's that minute of deflate in between each exercise.
Got it. That's a great answer. I've done a couple self experiments with doing BFR in the clinic with using some of the blood flow. They're actually the cuffs that are built for it. And I've had some days that I get really sore and other days that I don't get really sore post. Do you have that experience with patients? How do you determine, how do you educate? Do you see a change over time with how people react to it and respond to it?
Yeah, you know, I'll tell you, it seems really random. And I've tried to look at this from doing, you know, tons of patients over the years. I usually warn them and I, you know, just like with, it's similar. So I do dry needling also. It's similar to needling. You know, I'll usually tell patients you're going to be very sore, or, you know, or don't be surprised if later on today or tomorrow you're feeling very sore, that's going to subside. I tell them the same thing with BFR. You just worked a lot harder than you probably had worked in a long time. So don't be surprised if you're very sore the next day. And I've had some come in and say, oh yeah, I was sore for like 4 days. And others come in that did in a similar situation and say, yeah, I really wasn't that sore. I didn't feel too much. Or I was tired that next day, but that's about it. So
would you adjust it at all?
It really varies. And I don't see a good, if they're too sore, will I adjust it?
Yeah.
Yeah, you could, but I mean, if it's soreness and it's just muscle fatigue, I usually tell patients, you know, don't be afraid of a little bit of post-exercise soreness. It's not going to kill you. So if that was all that you had, yeah, maybe we went a little bit too heavy. We could back that off a little bit the next time, but, I'm just like when you just start an exercise program, if you're sore the next day, you know, we do different exercises or different muscle groups the following time.
Let's do this as one of the last questions, and maybe if you got anything else you want to touch on. There's been a couple of questions, and it's different, but people would talk about neurological patients, from myasthenia gravis to a paraplegic to any of those. Have you seen any studies with neurological patients? And then, yeah, let's stick with that for the first part.
Yeah, so as far as if I've seen any studies, the only one I referenced in this talk was the one with that muscle wasting, that 65-year-old man with the degenerative muscle wasting disease. I actually had a therapist in my clinic a couple of years ago that did a research project on an older patient with a neurological weakness with degenerative changes, and he had great results with that. I used to treat a lot of neurologic patients. I just don't anymore. So I can't say, you know, what I've seen, if I've used it with them, because I haven't, but I've definitely read some studies that have looked at using it with those patients.
And I might have missed you talk about this early on in the presentation, but there's a number of people who asked about cancer. With cancer, post-cancer treatment, have you treated anybody who's, you know, maybe in remission for a few months, or like, I just curiosities around your thoughts around cancer.
Yeah, I mean, I think you have to be careful. I think you have to be careful. Obviously, if anybody's undergoing treatment, I'm not going to do it with them at that time. If they've had breast cancer and they've had any type of lymph node surgery, I'm not going to mess with it. I don't want to put that added compression on that. So for patients like that, I'm probably going to avoid it. Most, I think if you look at some of the research asking, can you do it if proximal to where a cancer has been, it's one of those precautions. It's not contraindicated. I tend to err on the side of being cautious. So it's probably not going to be my go-to for them. Now, if it was something years and years ago and they've been cleared, then I'm not that worried about it.
Excellent. Well, there's a ton of other questions in here. I know that we can go through and I think we can answer some of these posts, maybe even send some typing, but I feel like we've presented a pretty, you did a great job, man. This was a lot of good information. And so
thanks for guiding us through it. You know, I think it's one of those things that we've talked about a lot on the Google group, and you'll see things where somebody submits an article and says, you know, what do you think about this with, you know, looked at blood flow restriction with this, or people ask about using it, whether it's with athletes or with different populations. And I'm definitely a believer in it. I think the science of it kind of speaks for itself. And, you know, like I said, in the first slide, I'm the most skeptical one out there. You know, if there's something that somebody says, hey, you got to come try this new modality, this new machine, I'm like, nah, that's not for me. So I'm not going to buy into things like that. But when you really look at the science behind it and you're thinking, oh yeah, that is what happens to the body when you exercise, and there's a way that I can do that and not stress it. And then you start playing around with it and you see the results with it. You know, that's what made me a believer. The science made me say, all right, I'll try it. And then starting to do it on patients and seeing the changes that we got with them, that's where I started to say, all right, I think there's something to this. I'm going to keep using it and keep looking into it a little bit more.
Excellent. Well, pleasure. For everybody who's still watching, we do have Vicky, my mother, is doing the CFS one on Saturday. So right now that's waitlisted. We have a full 500 people that are registered for that. And then we're hoping to set more of these up in the future. And I think, Seth, you've got so many topics there. There might be something else we can get you back on to talk about in the future.
Sounds good. Be happy to do it.
Yeah, this has been great. And we will see you all. And as I said, we're going to get this posted at some place. And I'll email all of the participants who had registered for it to let you know where it's posted so that you guys can all see. Thanks, Seth.
Sounds good. Thanks, Ryan. Great job.